Our way of life is a precious gift, one to be celebrated at every opportunity. With friends. While pursuing our passions, during quality time spent with our loved ones. And yet, many of us need help to maintain the quality of life we so deserve. That's why we've developed Petrolify. Petrolify is highly refined, all-natural ingredients are proven to meet the high energy demands of our modern lifestyles. A daily regimen of Petrolify enables you to more fully enjoy the precious gift of life. With Petrolify, you'll feel as though you can move the heavens and earth to satisfy not just your basic needs, but your every want. The secret behind Petrolify is a proprietary blend of hydrocarbons and organic compounds known as petroleum. Every single pill contains literally millions of years of stored solar energy. In fact, you could say we took sunlight and put it in a bottle. Petrolify might not be for everyone. Consult your doctor before taking. Side effects may include oil spills, deforestation, depression, loss of identity, corporatization, aquifer depletion, delusions of grandeur, birth defects, habitat loss, George W. Bush, the 405 in Los Angeles, ice cap melting, loss of democracy, thermonuclear warfare, species extinction, fracking, Al Gore, melting glaciers, oil price shocks, petrodollar imperialism, fuel-centered foreign policy, consumerism, automobile dependency, native culture loss, Wall Street tycoon, traffic jam, the Dukes of Hazzard, Frankenfood, military adventurism, and extreme cases, total and complete. Petrolify. Don't just seize the day. Seize life.
You like that? I thought that was relevant, especially with the climate march and all that a couple weeks ago. So look here, we're live. The evolution will be televised and it's happening right now. So I'm super excited to welcome my next guest to speak today. Dr. Jay Lombard is the co-founder of GenoMind. He is also the former assistant professor of neurology at New York Presbyterian Albert Einstein. He is the former chief neurologist at the Bronx Lebanon Hospital. And he was referred to us by a couple of our favorite doctors here at the Functional Forum, Dr. Morrison and Dr. Hoffman, who both said that he really has the goods. Now, I was going to give him that introduction earlier, but yesterday I was on a epic high-powered email chain that Dr. Brogan here started, and Jay actually participated in it, and he probably didn't know that I was on it, but I saw what he said, so I got a little look into the mind of this guy and who he really is. And I just want to read you what he wrote. He said, "Let me point out the obvious, though, in case we overlook it in efforts to improve the well-being of our patients. The macro issue is as important as the molecular ones. What is the macro issue, in my opinion? It's the realization that every neuropsych issue is fundamentally about disconnectivity. The principle is no less apt at receptor sites to the relationship to ourselves, our loved ones, and the universe." I just thought that was really beautifully said, and that is the character and the quality of person that we love to have here at the Functional Forum. So, here we go. This is Dr. Jay Lombard with the third wave of biological psychiatry.
Is there a pointer? Let's see. Thank you very much. It's a hard act to follow, that wonderful new drug made for us. Trying to get some samples from my rep. So we are at a very critical point in healthcare, and I think that those of us who are have the opportunity to treat patients with psychiatric problems know it's an incredible responsibility and also an incredible honor, because unlike other areas of medicine, psychiatric conditions impact us in the deepest way, really. People with depression or dementia or schizophrenia or autism, those other conditions, affects the entire experience of being human. So I think that this takes a great deal of understanding and responsibility to be involved in the care of patients like that. And I'm really honored to be here to speak to you tonight about what I titled the third wave of biological psychiatry. And why do we need this wave? Well, the first issue is that we know that mental disorders are highly ubiquitous, right? So I think that if I asked people in this room, how many of you had direct experiences with a psychiatric problem, either in your personal life or professional life, I would be, I think we'd all be hard-pressed to say that there's any person here who's escaped some direct experience with either depression or post-traumatic stress disorder, autism or ADHD. So these are really, really ubiquitous conditions. I think that they're affecting just about everybody. And the question is why, right? Why is it so ubiquitous? And it, you know, if you look at conventional psychiatry, how good a job are they doing in regards to treating patients with psychiatric problems? And this is called the STAR-D study. The STAR-D study looked at, these are tertiary care centers, so you know, major teaching hospitals across the United States, very good at psychopharmacology, highly experienced, taking patients with severe depression, not just you know the worried well people with very, very severe mental illness. And what is shown here is that there's a significant percentage of patients who remain refractory despite optimal types of care and therapy. And the question is, why is that the case? I mean, this is not, you know, going to your local psychopharmacologist. This is, you know, the cream of the crop in terms of using medications and people exposed to 3, 4, 5 medications, and yet we still see a significant, substantial number of people who remain refractory. And this is depression. If we take post-traumatic stress disorder, we don't have any treatments for that condition. We just don't. If you look at autism, which is not one condition, by the way, it's many different conditions, we don't have good treatments for that. If we look at schizophrenia, we don't have good treatments for these conditions. So why? What is it we're missing here? And, you know, there's obviously, this could be a very, very long discussion, but let's just talk about this idea of stress, because we all use this term, but what does it actually mean from a molecular type of pathway? What does stress do to us? Because stress is one of these things that doesn't cause any particular disease, but contributes to almost every single one of them. So I think we need to understand the role that stress plays in the biology of psychiatric conditions like depression. And I don't want your eyes to roll over this, because my goal is to actually show you that stress, the pathology of stress, really integrates lots of different systems in our biology, including the endocrine system, the adrenal glands, our heart rate, blood pressure, all these different parameters that play a role in this condition. And I really don't want your eyes to roll over, but to show you this, I think, very important slide, and I'm going to try to make this very sexy so that maybe they'll do a cartoon about this someday. But why is this slide so important to me and for this lecture today? Because it explains something that's very, very important to understanding neuropsychiatry. And the question is, how does our phenomenology, how do our mental states affect our biology? How is it if we experience things like stress, depression, loss of attachment of our PowerPoint presentation? How do those really negative emotional experiential states affect our biology? And the second question is, how does our biology affect our phenomenology? How is it that things that go on at the molecular level affect our cognition and our emotional states? So I think it's worth kind of walking through this as a roadmap to understand where there are opportunities for us, both in non-pharmacological or other types of strategies, to actually reduce this pathological cascade. So here we have the state called stress and depression as, you know, sort of the ubiquitous state of being alive in the year 2014. I don't know why that happens, but we have this neurotransmitter called glutamate, which is an excitatory neurotransmitter. This sets into motion a cascade of really negative pathological processes in neurons in the brain, including a heightened influx of calcium into neurons, high cortisol. These effects affect both the nucleus and the mitochondria. So we hear a lot about mitochondrial dysfunction in psychiatry and neurology. One of the ways that happens is that these negative signals through glutamate actually converge on the mitochondria and change the permeability of mitochondria in such a way that you end up releasing pro-death factors. Okay, factors that basically communicate to the cell that life is no longer worth living. They're called caspases. And wow, again, I'll probably never be invited back here again if I keep doing that, sorry. So what does that actually mean? So it's not important to understand exactly all these steps, but just to show you there's a direct relationship between phenomenology and biology, where if a person's experiencing a state of life not worth living, that gets communicated to the biology. It gets communicated to the biology through these pathways in which pro-death factors, these apoptotic factors, communicate to the cell to go into apoptosis or cell death. Okay, now it's not all bad news, okay? So we have what are called pro-life messages as well. Those pro-life messages come from neurotrophic factors, things like BDNF, or brain-derived neurotrophic factor. These coordinate things like serotonin and other catecholamines to promote these factors that actually inhibit cell death and promote cell life. So you have this kind of yin-yang process going on between our biology and our phenomenology about whether life is worth living or not. Interestingly, if we look at BDNF, there are lots of things that we can do to increase BDNF that are non-pharmacological, right? Moving, physical exercise will promote BDNF. Certain dietary supplements, including omega-3 fish oil and certain flavonoids, promote BDNF. So these actually have been looked at as novel antidepressants because of their role on promoting BDNF. Now, the second thing we can do is block this pathological, you know, cell death pathway by either blocking glutamate, reducing cortisol, or reducing this high calcium. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in a couple of minutes as well. So, and now this thing doesn't go forward well. Okay, so what happens under stress is that the hippocampus, which is our memory center, is the most vulnerable. That's why there's a high risk of developing Alzheimer's. Depression is one of the major risk factors for developing Alzheimer's disease. You can develop atrophy of these memory centers with prolonged stress, probably due to persistently elevated cortisol, which is a neurotoxin. High cortisol is a toxin to the brain. If you look at these conditions, you know, major depression, post-traumatic stress disorder, Alzheimer's disease, all kind of converge on this high cortisol promoting cell death. Okay, and this is a long slide that I'm probably going to skip in the interest of time, but those of you that really love neuroscience, just to show you some of the key takeaway points here, which are basically due to the fact that stress has an effect on dendrites, which are the communication network of the brain, synapses, and neurogenesis. And those of you that really want to know much more about this kind of work, right here at Rockefeller, Bruce McEwen has done most of the most important work on the effects of stress, its damaging effects in the brain. So we need to take a top-down approach. Before we go into the molecular stuff, what's a top-down approach mean? Basic things, promoting physical activity, cognitive behavioral therapy, mindfulness, prayer, social support, integration. These are, you know, the kind of obvious things that we've kind of extracted away from psychiatry by having a model where it's a drug-only model. These are really basic, and the reason that they're not promoted is you can't sell them. I mean, that's unfortunately why they're not overly utilized in healthcare. Now, what about a bottom-up approach? So at Genomine, we've looked at key genes that are related to psychiatric symptoms despite what a particular diagnosis is. And I'm going to go through a couple of these with you because they're really, really quite interesting. So first of all, something called the serotonin transporter gene. How many of you actually have heard of that gene? So about half of you have. So this is interesting work that began with Dr. Caspi at Duke University that looked at the effects of the serotonin transporter and its role in stress reactivity and vulnerability for depression. What he discovered, and I'll show you some of the data on this, is that your risk of developing a major depressive episode or post-traumatic stress disorder or other psychiatric symptoms was directly related to the presence of short transporter alleles, meaning that something genetically about the serotonin transporter led to vulnerability. So just really quickly, a short means that the transporter is shorter, literally, the serotonin transporter, versus a long transporter. And this is one of these, you know, size really does matters kinds of genes. But it's very clear linear axis relationship between vulnerability for depression and having the presence of these short transporters. Why is this significant, this particular study? Because it tells us two things. It's not strictly biology, and it's not strictly nurture. It's really a nature and nurture story where you have to have both sort of a perfect storm of genetic biological vulnerability with the experience, because you can have the worst genes in the world. If you don't have exposure to negative situations or negative life trauma, you're not going to get these types of conditions. You need this, what's called epistasis between genes and environment. Another gene that was really, made the New York Times, which is, the gold standard of medical literature. This was a paper that came out, and this, to me, when I go around speaking in the country to psychiatrists, this is such an important piece of data. And yet people look at me like, what are you talking about? So I have to try to explain this. So calcium genes are basically ion channels in the brain. And I tell psychiatrists they need to think of themselves as cardiologists of the brain. Because just like in the heart, we have ion channels that relate to the excitation of the brain or the relaxation of the brain. The same thing in the heart, the same thing is true in the brain. So that excitation is related to the traveling of these calcium channels, all right? Now, why is that big news? Because in many different studies, these calcium channel genes have been displayed to be abnormal, regardless of what the psychiatric condition was. Schizophrenia, bipolar, autism, major depression, ADD are very different clinically, and yet the presence of these calcium channel genes is significantly more likely to have a variant in them with those conditions. What does that tell us? It tells us that fundamentally, psychiatric and neurological diseases are diseases of imbalance between excitation and inhibition, sort of a yin-yang idea of going towards something or retracting. These ion channels regulate the oscillation of the brain. And when you have these variants, no matter what your condition is, this gives us a much more specific target to treat these patients rather than symptomatically. Okay, and now it doesn't want to move at all. So anyway, so one of the neurotransmitters you've probably heard about is called glutamate, which is related to these calcium channels. And guess what? We see patients that with seizures have a higher rate of ion channel genetic variants, migraine, neuropathic pain in the psychiatric area, bipolar, post-traumatic stress disorder, autism, and TRD. So we can move away from a categorical diagnosis. We say, you're autistic. No, you're not autistic. You're bipolar. No, you're not bipolar. Maybe you're schizoaffective. I mean, this is what goes on in terms of psychiatric diagnosis. The discovery of these channels moves us away from a categorical nomenclature to a dimensional analysis where we're talking about what's the underlying biology of these conditions. I mean, that is really exciting, at least to me. Okay, so what happens? What is the problem here with calcium ions? What's the big deal? Well, what happens is that there's a neurotransmitter called glutamate, which is like the Jimi Hendrix of neurotransmitters, okay? Glutamate amplifies stuff. It activates stuff. So it's involved in memory. It's involved in cognition. But too much glutamate leads to cell death. And we know that a lot of neurological and psychiatric disorders are associated with this hyperglutaminergic state. So it's worth going through this process. We release glutamate. It binds to receptors. It opens up those ion channels, right? This is what we talked about, these genes that allow these ion channels to get into the neuron, activating these lipases, proteases, endonucleases. These guys are like detergent for the cellular structures, and you have cell death. So here's the cascade. Right, we have glutamate, excitotoxicity, it gets into those neurons through these ion channels, we have cell death. Now we can begin thinking about a much more rational approach to neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's, to conditions like Parkinson's disease, where there's been data that by regulating these calcium channels, we can actually be neuroprotective in certain degrees. We're really kind of honing in on what is the enemy in the brain at a molecular level, right? Still have to go to the macro level after I can turn this thing over again. Okay, so what do we do about it, right? So I don't want to be a doom and gloom guy. I hear that from my wife enough, so I don't want to, belabor the doom and gloom. She tells me not to watch the news anymore. But okay, so what can we do non-pharmacologically that can actually reduce glutamate and be neuroprotective and help as antidepressants and other effects? And these are all pretty strongly evidence-based nutrients. The one I would tell you that is most strongly evidence-based is something called N-acetylcysteine, and it is a very inexpensive supplement. There are hundreds of clinical trials in terms of its relationship of being efficacious in things like addiction, autism, schizophrenia, and depression. Okay. So what does N-acetylcysteine do? It's a novel glutamate antagonist. It reduces this Jimi Hendrix excitotoxic neurotransmitter. It does it by actually regulating the exchange of glutamate for something called cysteine, which is an antioxidant. And again, there's several beneficial studies that you can feel free to Google today on its beneficial effects in a number of neurological and psychiatric conditions. Besides N-acetylcysteine, we have the inability to do this again. Okay. Okay, so let's just, this slide's a little bit out of order, but here is our way of actually regulating these abnormal calcium channels where we want to prevent this from getting into the neurons. There are lots of pharmacological and non-pharmacological ways of dampening glutamate neurotransmission and preventing this excitotoxicity. So omega-3 fish oil, one of the ways that it's actually cardioprotective as well as neuroprotective is by preventing this excess of calcium from entering into neurons. Okay, magnesium is another example of a compound that actually occupies this channel like a bouncer at a nightclub, preventing excess of calcium from depolarizing the neurons. So magnesium, very inexpensive, very good agent to reduce this excitability. And this is just a graphic of that. Here's the glutamate NMDA receptor. Magnesium occupies this channel, preventing the excess sodium or calcium into the neuron, preventing this excess of depolarization. Taurine is, unfortunately for the Red Bull makers, is really not a greatly positioned amino acid, but although it does help mitochondria. But taurine is a compound that actually reduces excitability as well. And it does it in a very similar way by preventing this excess of calcium influx in neurons. And here's something we hear a lot about, and this is actually quite a long discussion about this idea of inflammatory processes. And many of you have probably seen Brain on Fire. It was a book that was written about a woman that had something called NMDA encephalitis. Rare condition. People should not go out and ask their doctors if they have it. It's not very common. But NMDA is the glutamate receptor, and this particular patient had antibodies to glutamate that led to her psychotic condition. We now know that many neurological and psychiatric conditions are associated with a hyperinflammatory state. If we go back to that first slide I showed you, where you have this abnormal cortisol and glutamate, the best way to think about this, in my mind, is that pro-inflammatory states and glutamate states are really parallel. So if you think about glutamate as being exciting the nervous system, the pro-inflammatory states are doing the same thing in the immune system. Okay. In fact, arachidonic acid, which is a pro-inflammatory molecule, actually blocks glutamate reuptake. So by having an inflammatory condition where you have high arachidonic acid, you are basically giving more glutamate to the brain, more neurotoxicity. An inflammatory relationship, really, you can't open up any journal right now and finding significant evidence of the inflammatory processes. 5 minutes left? Okay. So, to cut to the chase here, some of the things that we developed at Genomind are looking at ways of using genetic testing to help clinicians both use pharmacological and non-pharmacological. We are an integrative company. We don't believe that medications are inherently evil. It's just that we're not using them properly. So we're trying to really help to refine choices for doctors in choosing either medications or non-pharmacological agents based upon genotyping. If we take things like the serotonin transporter, what information, how useful is that to a psychiatrist or to a mental health provider? Well, it tells them that this patient has higher stress vulnerability, lower stress resilience, higher cortisol. Okay, so things that actually reduce cortisol and reduce that fight or flight response could be very, very helpful for patients. Okay, and just a quick study here. We took those STAR-D patients, the ones I showed you earlier, treatment-resistant patients, patients who failed three or more medications, whether it's SSRIs, Wellbutrin. These are very treatment-resistant patients. We gave the psychiatrists who are part of the study genotyping to allow them to actually get better treatment choices based upon looking at the biology of these conditions. And this was quite remarkable. What we discovered is that these patients who were refractory to everything actually started getting better, okay? Big, big numbers here. And the people that we've shown this data to, which are like psychiatrists at Mass General that have really, really put us to the really have asked us, you know, why is this happening? Why is this happening? So we actually looked at specific things that actually make a huge difference that the doctors would not have otherwise had at their choice. And those are things like methylfolate, which is a non-pharmacological agent, increases catecholamines, helps with depression in certain patients. Things like N-acetylcysteine we talked about. So this is, in my mind, the third wave of psychiatry, which is taking both biological data and psychological data, integrating it in a way where we treat the whole patient. And I think I made the time. Thank you.